introducing our keynote speaker this morning. Melissa is from Kaiser Permanente in San Francisco, and is actually has been a partner with the Alzheimer's Association for many years as a specialist. Melissa, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Have a wonderful day.
Okay, we've been at the Care Central Worker at Kaiser San Francisco. As Elizabeth said, Kaiser Permanente is a proud presenting sponsor of this conference, which aims to keep getting better and better year after year, thanks to the Alzheimer's Association. And I'm honored to present our keynote speaker, Dr. Howard Rosen, MD, who is a professor of neurology at the UCSF Department of Neurology, Memory, and Aging Center. Dr. Rosen received his MD from Boston University School of Medicine, then trained in internal medicine at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine in New York, and subsequently completed a neurology residency at UCSF. He is board certified in both internal medicine and neurology. After residency, Dr. Rosen pursued fellowship training in brain imaging at the Washington University School of Medicine, and then returned to UCSF to join the team at the Memory and Aging Center in 1999. Dr. Rosen participates in the evaluation of new patients in the Memory and Aging Center clinic, as well as the continued management of care for some of these individuals in the continuity clinic. As a part of the Memory and Aging Center and the UCSF Department of Neurology, he participates in the training of medical students, residents, and fellows. In addition to his clinical responsibilities, Dr. Rosen maintains an active research program. His primary area of interest is in the organization of the emotional systems in the brain and how these systems are affected in different forms of dementia. His research combines methods of assessing emotional function in the brain with brain imaging in both patients and cognitively normal individuals. Dr. Rosen, we're so happy to have you. Welcome.
Thanks very, very much for inviting me, and it's a pleasure to be here. Realizing I need to buy more purple clothing. Sorry for that, I wasn't completely prepared. I just want to thank everybody for having me here. So my job, I think, is to tell you what I think is new in the landscape of dementia and neurodegenerative disease. That's what I'm going to do today. And the title of my talk is this is the title. And I have just some minor disclosures. I do have some relationships with pharmaceutical companies, consulting with them on clinical trials design, investigations for frontotemporal dementia, which is very specialty to us. I also want to just a good place to remind you that patient following law in the pack, I made a few minor changes to the slides, mostly ordering and a few other things. Don't get confused. And probably one other disclosure is I was certified in internal medicine, but it lapsed, so you know, that's not really, that was a long time ago. I was the first person that didn't get grandfathered. That first year. I missed the life from this many different neurologists, so just riding away a little bit behind. Anyway, so that's the disclosure part. So I think to frame the talk, I think it's valuable to sort of think about how I think traditionally we thought about dementia. Certainly this represents how I think I learned about dementia when I was in medical school. And although there's been a lot of change in dementia over the years, I still think it's a lot of the framing for many clinicians in the community that this is kind of the way they see dementia, is that a dementia diagnosis is a diagnosis of exclusion. And when we make diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, it's not based on any specificity, but just a excluding a bunch of other problems that might be causing a cognitive complaint, that we can't really predict who has dementia or not, and that many people, if they're complaining about their memory, they probably don't have dementia. And that, in fact, it's only the severe version that we kind of have in our head, where people are often not so aware of the problems anymore. That's the time that many of us are ready to diagnose dementia. And if there's nothing we can do about it to prevent it, that's an old, I think, myth as well, and then we can't treat it. And so I think my goal is to say these views are changing. That's not the state of the art in dementia care and research anymore. And I'm going to try to update you on how much each of these elements has changed. I wish there could be more changes in every element, but there's definitely changes in every element of this thing. And I think we're close to every bullet point on here being significantly addressed very soon. So first, we're really going to talk about Alzheimer's disease, which is the most common form of dementia that we think about. We're going to talk about how we diagnose it briefly, because I think everything starts with diagnosis, and some new tools that we have now in our armamentarium, and some treatments, what they are now, which I think most people know, and also a little bit about where they're going to come from. And I think it's really important to talk about other forms of dementia. And although they're less common, the differential diagnosis is critical, especially as we move forward into the new treatment era that I think we're coming toward. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. So the first part of this is this review of the symptoms that I think most people are pretty familiar with. So Alzheimer's disease is primarily a disease of memory. That's how we think of it. It's not unreasonable with a lot of variability. So that's meant not just any kind of memory. It's not forgetting what you do when you walk into a room, and it's not forgetting the names of people that you know well and having a little more trouble with that, because that's really common with aging. But it's that memory for recent events and episodes. Something happened last week, and now I don't remember that it happened, and I missed the appointment, or things like that. And there's a lot more detail that people can learn about. That's the earliest problem. It's the most common problem. But also, Alzheimer's disease causes problems in a lot of other areas of function, including the word finding that I mentioned. It shouldn't be the only problem, but it definitely happens. And planning, and organizing, and finding your way around familiar places, and it also causes some social and emotional changes, like apathy or low motivation, and irritability and agitation. And in different patients, you can see all these different groups. Sometimes, some of these things are the earliest and most important feature in that patient. The memory problem is less common, but that's a typical, less common presentation that, in a separate box, I'd be happy to talk about. There's lots of places to find out about that. It's a slowly progressive disorder, and by definition, for us to call it dementia, it has to impact daily living in a meaningful way. For instance, I used to pay the bills, but now I can't because I can't remember too anymore, or it affects work or various things. So I'll come next to some degree to all these points, because this is a really critical framing for how we diagnose Alzheimer's, but it's also a framing we have to understand isn't perfect. So I think it's really important to briefly review the biology of the disease in a very simple way. So remember that Alzheimer's disease is we believe, a disease that's caused by accumulation of proteins that have normal jobs in the brain, for whatever reason. They're not doing their normal jobs, so they start to accumulate and little globs inside the nerve cells and outside the nerve cell. The two main proteins I'm talking about are, of course, amyloid, which is made up of A-beta-42, which is a little component of this larger protein called APP, and tau. So the plaques that we hear about, they're just accumulations of A-beta-42 in amyloid, and the tangles that we hear about, those are accumulations of tau inside the neurons. This slide I already referred to is that A-beta-42 comes from APP. So obviously when you think about it, these microscopic changes, they must happen all over the brain, and to some degree that's true. So the question is, why is there any kind of specific clinical presentation to Alzheimer's disease? How come we can recognize it? Because it turns out that the changes that we just described, they don't happen all over the brain at once. they have a predictable pattern that many people, that's how they move through the brain. And the most common pattern is that these changes start to in the medial temporal lobe. So this is obviously a picture of the brain. This is as if you split the brain in half and we're looking at the inside wall on this case the left half of the brain, go like that. And you can see in yellow they depicted sort of in a pathology slide, if you saw, in somebody who had a fast brain, you looked at their brain at autopsy, this would be the part of the brain where you would find, if you found any changes of Alzheimer's, you would find them here. And then, as we see more evidence of Alzheimer's disease, more and more impacting people's brains, it starts to spread from this region to other parts of the brain. And by the time you have very significant memory complaints, it's really affecting quite a lot of regions. So this part of the brain, the medial temporal lobe, contains a structure called the hippocampus, which is one of the most important structures for memory, laying down memory. And so we believe that because Alzheimer's disease typically starts in this region of the brain and affects this memory, very important structure of memory, that's why the earliest symptoms are these memory problems that I talked about. And so you can see, as the brain, as the problem starts to spread, there's lots of other parts of the brain that are involved. That's why you start seeing those other symptoms that I talked about. Symptoms from the language domain, or the parts of the brain that have to do getting around, or organizing and planning. It's because of that spread. So you can already imagine that one thing we have a problem with is, by the time we're recognizing all those symptoms, this is a disease that's not in its earliest phase anymore. And that's a problem we're going to have to revisit. And in fact, what I just described, kind of knowing that pattern exists and being able to basically take a careful history that kind of collects the information to identify that pattern, that's still how we make a diagnosis, even in 2018. That hasn't changed. And if you don't take the time to actually paint that picture in your head of that's what is happening in this person, it's not necessarily going to be an accurate diagnosis. I'll talk about how that's changing, but that's still the core. And of course, one of the problems is that process has to have evolved to some point for us to know it's there just by talking to people and by doing cognitive testing. So that's where we are today, right? Is we're looking for this pattern based on a clinical history combined with some neuropsychological tests. So we are developing new tools, though. So one of the problems is just because I recognize that pattern doesn't mean I can see those blocks and tangles. And it turns out that sometimes they aren't there. So sometimes people can have that same syndrome I described, but it's from another neurodegenerative cause. And probably once in a while, it's not neurodegenerative even if it's not that bad. So that's still a problem we've discovered through use of this technique. So now we have a PET scan-based technique called amyloid imaging. So you can inject a chemical that sticks to the amyloid in the brain. It's radioactive. Most people know what a PET scan is. So all you do is take a picture of the brain after 20 or 30 minutes. And by that point, this chemical should have left the brain. If you can still get this radioactive signal from your brain, the only conclusion is there must be amyloid for this chemical to stick to. And that's been well validated with autopsy studies showing that indeed that's what you find in the brain if this signal exists. So we call this amyloid imaging now. It's approved by the FDA for the purpose of identifying this amyloid. And we know now that when you have that typical clinical syndrome that I described, most cases do have amyloid, but even in expert hands, places like Stanford Center or Adam Center or other memory centers, maybe 10 to 20% still don't have amyloid. So it's important. That doesn't mean there's nothing wrong with that person, but it shifts. And of course, if they do have the amyloid, it really nails down and confirms that we know what you're dealing with, and that has value in and of itself. So for many reasons, I think we'll be starting to use this kind of amyloid imaging and similar approaches more over time. So what does our treatment look like now? So the current treatments are approved treatments are Namenda and cholinesterase inhibitors. And you know, what I've alluded to is the idea that this neurodegenerative disease, Alzheimer's, has some selectivity. It doesn't affect the whole brain once. There's certain parts that are vulnerable and others that are less vulnerable. So it turns out one part of the brain that's vulnerable very early in the course of Alzheimer's is another part of the brain in the medial frontal lobes of the nucleus facialis of minor, that doesn't matter. But anyway, it's a part of the brain that makes acetylcholine, and that acetylcholine is distributed to the whole brain via diffuse pathways. And acetylcholine, you know, has a function of kind of fine-tuning neuronal function. And so what happens is, whatever's going on in the rest of the brain, there's not enough acetylcholine around because this one spot is particularly bad. So what cholinesterase inhibitors do is block the breakdown of acetylcholine, they raise the level a little bit, and that results in some improvement in function. Clearly, that treatment is not getting at the amyloid and tau directly that we talked about. That's why we don't call it disease-modifying. It's a form of symptomatic therapy, but it is valuable. So this is a particular study from donepezil, one of the first ones approved that's also safe. But there are others that are similar efficacy. And what the studies have shown is if you compare over time, you watch people's clinical state over a few months, that the people, if they were treated with a placebo, show a decline, or if the people on a cholinesterase inhibitor show less decline. It's in memory, and they typically use memory and are kind of a combo test that also captures some of these other elements like gaming and executive functions, you know, organizing, as well as a sort of general impression of how people are doing. There are ways to at least quantify that, even though it's very subjective. So most studies that would approve a drug have to try to capture both of those things. Something objectively measurable, like with testing, and another thing that just generally says, are they doing okay? Is that relatively better or worse? So I think it's really important that to understand this pattern, because when you give a drug to a patient or their family, their family's expecting to see something too, everybody wants improvement, right? And I can understand that. But I tell people, well, that's not really what the study showed. You know, if you didn't see improvement, well, that wouldn't be unexpected, because the study showed that it slows a decline relative to what you would have known. So people have to understand that, and I tell them, if you feel that you've gotten some improvement, that you notice, that's great. It's hard to prove or disprove or measure. I'm very happy to hear it. But you're really taking it on the faith in the many research studies that show it's better to be on it than not. And so really what I tell them is, the most important thing is that you don't feel bad on it. You don't have adverse effects. And if you do, we can find another, potentially another formulation of one of the other companies' drugs. They all work similarly, and they all have sort of similar side effects. But like many drugs, somebody might not tolerate one, and a slightly different formulation might be better tolerated. So you really have to set people's expectations. And you also have to fight the myth. So most studies only get done for a year or two, right? You can't fake them forever. But many clinicians take away the impression that because that's how long the study was, that's how long the drug was. You have no evidence that that's the case. In fact, any time you start one of these drugs in any phase of illness, mild, moderate, or severe, it always has an effect, and as long as people start taking that. So we don't have any reason to believe that you only get 6 months from this drug, and I've heard that many, many times. So that's important too. Go ahead. Yeah. So I'm going to repeat the question, and I'm also probably not going to take too many more questions for now. I apologize, but I'm also going to leave it at the end. So this woman asked, I'm sorry, I don't know your name. She heard that if you stop the drug, that you have a decline. So that makes sense, because you've been boosting this acetylcholine, and all of a sudden, you're not boosting it anymore. So you're going to feel that, right? So it makes sense that you won't feel as well. There have been some concerns that if you restart it after a few weeks, people may never, they don't quite get to the level that they were if they were on it before. So I think we try to resist stopping it, but there are so many clinical reasons that things get started and stopped that it's not always easy to abide by strict strict rules about don't ever stop it or things like that. I mean, I certainly act as if it has to stop for some reason, like somebody ran into the hospital, okay, so be it, and then we'll be smart when things settle down, and you know, I have full expectation that it still should have some effect. So, and of course, the many other symptoms that I'm kind of grouping under this term psychiatry, I alluded to them before, have to deal with low motivation, depression, Morpholz syndrome, anxiety, psychosis, delusions, and sometimes hallucination. We see all these. And in fact, even though there are FDA-approved treatments for those kinds of symptoms, some of them, in other contexts, there are no FDA-approved treatments for these kinds of symptoms within the context of dementia. And I'm not really an expert in those trials and explaining why they didn't work yet. There's a lot of complicated reasons. But people have to know that essentially there's a rule book or guidebook on how to do this. I think we all do this based on our intuition and our experience. I think at the Memory Center, we do certainly know that there's as much evidence for less problematic drugs like SSRIs, some antidepressants, as there is for antipsychotics. So I always feel like we should start with those, and we know that even though somebody is not depressed, things like antidepressants can sometimes help with non-depressive symptoms like agitation or anxiety. So we always try those first, but we recognize that, you know, we're not using it based on the strongest of evidence, but rather just kind of general principle. Let's try. We know antipsychotics often have worse symptoms than the problem. But we can't be afraid to use them. Hitting or striking and causing safety concerns for themselves or others, that's an appropriate use of what antipsychotics used to be called, which is major tranquilizer. And they do that, and it's not necessarily a great outcome for the patient in that situation, but there is a place for them. So that's kind of where things are at. And I'd like to talk now about this other thing that one might call a treatment, but it's really more relevant for the prevention side. So there's a lot of data showing that many of the things that relate in particular to cardiovascular risk are also risks independently for brain health, not necessarily via vascular mechanism. We're still learning that. All of these things on the list. And there's work showing that at a population scale, if we could get rid of or reduce the prevalence of those things, it would have a big impact on the outcome of dementia. So this is from Christine Yaffe's group at UCSF. They did this study where they basically modeled that you could sort of reduce the prevalence of, like, I think the 7 risk factors they focused on, diabetes, hypertension, et cetera, by 20%, we would prevent, you know, 15 million cases worldwide by 2015. And there's, you know, other statistics relevant to the U.S. and some people too. So it's a big deal. If you already developing cognitive impairment or you already have dementia, and, you know, what is the impact of intervening in these lifestyle factors, we know less about that, which I think means we should still recommend it. We just can't be as presumptuous about knowing what impact it's going to have. So we still do recommend it. And I think it's important to focus on, which many physicians in many contexts focus on. So that's kind of a really brief bird's eye view of the current state of treatment. There's a lot more to be said. I don't have time for. What about future treatment? Where are future treatments going to come from? Well, of course, if we believe these amyloid and tau, you know, proteins are a problem, that's where our therapies, our development is directed. We're trying to do things which decrease the accumulation or clear these things from the brain. And a lot of work in the last 10 to 15 years has focused on that A-beta-42 and the amyloid. So there's vaccines that have been developed that help it clear from the brain, or agents that interfere with the processing of it by interacting with an enzyme called gamma secretase or beta secretase. These are all in the pathways of how it gets processed in the cells. And a big summary of all of those things, like many studies, they all look really good in the animals and mice and cellular models, but when they were moved into people, they didn't work yet. And so what do we really know, well, just to spell that out a little more, is in some studies, they just didn't work. In other studies, they were able to use amyloid imaging to show that actually the drug did what it was supposed to do, and that it prevented the accumulation, or in some cases, even reduced the burden of amyloid in patients. But it didn't work clinically. So that's a tough thing for the pharmaceutical companies to deal with. It was supposed to do, and yet it didn't have the outcomes. So every time a drug doesn't work, you know, you really have to think about why it didn't work. And there are still other formulations of anti-amyloid therapies that are in the works, and they look very promising even in the small, you know, clinical kind of phase two level of study, but we'll just have to wait and see for the larger studies. This is kind of why we don't have a drug yet, is because they do what they're supposed to do partly biologically, but we haven't seen a clinical effect yet. So how are people dealing with this? Anyway, one is, as I said, we're not giving up on those animal studies. But we've also started to think about, well, maybe the problem is also this tau there. And this is, as I said, when you're identifying somebody with, you know, all the symptoms of dementia that I laid out, there's a lot going on in the brain because it's processed and spread to a lot of parts of the brain. So we're soft. One way to think about this is, well, maybe we should move earlier. So one of the things we learned by using amyloid is that it's around a lot longer, for many years before we develop symptoms. And the models often point to the fact that, so, you know, now that we've had amyloid, we studied use it in people who are cognitively normal, older people, and who have some mild symptoms, and of course, dementia. And so what we found is that it seems that amyloid is probably accumulating for about 10 to 15 years before a diagnosis of dementia. So obviously that's a period of time where we could potentially intervene, and maybe that same drug would have a bigger effect. And one context to think about this is a syndrome called mild cognitive impairment. I just want to review what that is now. So this is the same slide I showed before, and I told you how it, you know, all of these symptoms are relevant to dementia, they represent sort of spread. We talked about the fact that it didn't all start in all these places. It started in the speedotemporal world. So there is a syndrome that's pretty well defined that we now call mild cognitive impairment. So that's a syndrome where it's really mostly only the memory problems. And it's the same kind of complaints. There's not much of the word finding or not more than you would expect from normal aging, all of them getting lost and all of that. And in that phase, often the person is still able to accomplish all their normal activities because they can compensate for the memory problem by using lists or being more organized. Some people are just really organized at baseline, and it doesn't matter because they've got such great habits. I'm not one of those people, but I've met them. I know what they look like. So there's a lot of reasons that a limited memory problem might not have a big impact on your daily life, depending on many other factors. So really, that's the definition of mild cognitive impairment, that there are symptoms, in this case, memory, and they sound not normal for aging in terms of their severity and consistency. And that's a tough judgment to make. But that's one of the places that neuropsychology really comes in, because it can help verify, yes, indeed, this memory problem, as we measure it, is also. It indeed is not, they have memory problems that are bigger than you would expect for age. And it's still a slowly depressive story. So this mild cognitive impairment is kind of an area where people are starting to focus on now. And for about the last 20 years, it's been a very important area of study. We've learned a lot about it, and we know that it does increase your chance of progression to dementia, even if you just identify it clinically. Forgetting about the amyloid imaging, right? So just knowing you have mild cognitive impairment, if it's properly defined with some cognitive testing, we can put a number on how likely it is you're going to get dementia each year. And if your memory performance is really Alzheimer's-like in terms of severity and type on memory testing, then your chance of developing Alzheimer's can be, you know, up to 40% overall, and like kind of a 10% per year. It depends on the setting. That's in a very research setting, but it certainly increases your risk for longness. And of course, this is an area where we might potentially intervene earlier and prevent cognitive decline that's coming down the road. Now that we have amyloid imaging, we can further characterize this mild cognitive impairment. So as I said, even with affirmed dementia syndrome, some people have amyloid and some people don't. That's going to be true of mild cognitive impairment. And this is an example of a cognitively normal person who doesn't have amyloid, and somebody with an MCI, mild cognitive impairment syndrome, who who also doesn't have amyloid, and maybe they don't have any neurodegenerative, or maybe they have another neurodegenerative disease. And here's an example of a similar monocognitive impairment person, but who has amyloid. And you can see that the amyloid quantity is, just by the colors, I can trick you on the colors, but I'm not. The color scale is similar. And here, it's really as much amyloid as in this case of Alzheimer's disease. And that's what I told you. You know, by the time we're starting to see symptoms, a lot of amyloid is accumulated. So that's no surprise. So, and of course, if you add that to the syndrome, you say, well, I knew this was monocognitive impairment, and now I add amyloid into my information about this patient, then the likelihood of dementia occurring over time goes up. So it's a really important context to think about treatment for dementia, right? Now, we know all these studies I mentioned, we know that we even step back earlier than monocognitive impairment and look at people who are just normal elders who are at risk for dementia only because of our age and not necessarily any other special risk factor, right? So we learned that amyloid is even relevant in this group, of course. And so what we have found is that even in a group of normal elders, let's say over 70 or 75, a lot of people are going to have amyloid and not be noticing that those symptoms yet. And here's just an example where you have, one person who's 82 in this case and has no amyloid. Here's another person who's cognitively normal and you can start to see some amyloid. And here's a third person who has a lot more. And I'm going to come back to these examples in a minute. But all of these people are not feeling the effects of this yet. And actually, it's no surprise because we knew this from autopsy studies. There were already existing autopsy studies where people had followed people for many years. And they had followed people till death who had been cognitively normal really till their last days. And then they looked at their brain and they saw evidence of amyloid in the brain as much as you might see in Alzheimer's, and those people have been fine. So this finding in amyloid imaging, that we're going to see amyloid in people who are cognitively okay, is not a surprise, and it's a replication of things we already knew. So obviously there's sort of an extra difference between the people who have amyloid and are cognitively okay, and the people who have amyloid and are starting to feel the effects. So what are those differences? Well, one of those things is the clinical features I mentioned. So, and where do those clinical features come from? That's what defines things like MCI. It comes from other aspects of brain events. So, when these diseases start to affect the brain, it causes brain atrophy. The brain atrophy, we think, comes from as the nerve cells get bombarded with these protein problems, the synapses start to decline, so there are fewer of them, the nerve cells start to shrink. Of course, some of them die, not all of them. And that process, mostly the loss of synapses, causes on a large scale, because it's happening on a large scale, brain atrophy. Brain atrophy is normal with aging, but of course, because these diseases are happening, it's enhanced in these disorders. And it turns out that if you carefully measure hippocampal volumes using things like MRI, you can demonstrate that in some of the cognitive impairment, on average, they're medial temporal lobes or hippocampus, as I mentioned earlier, is smaller than an age-matched person who's cognitively normal. And so what we found is, as you would imagine, when laying it out, if you have amyloid and you have hippocampal atrophy, that's why you're having symptoms. Whereas if you have amyloid and you don't have hippocampal atrophy, that's why you're not having symptoms. So that's an indicator that whatever's going on has an effect on the brain in this way that it's causing the synapses to malfunction, starting to show these anatomical changes. And I'll come back. So there's a missing piece though, right? So there's this amyloid is a cause, that's fine. And by saying there's brain atrophy and cognitive impairment, they're both the same, right? The reason you have cognitive impairment is because you have brain atrophy. But what causes brain atrophy? So a lot of people are focusing on this other protein that I mentioned, which is tau. I mentioned earlier that there's this other protein, I think I'll go in this order, called tau, which is a component of those tangles that I mentioned. And the taus, nerve cells are very long, they have these axons, and so they require a lot of infrastructure and architecture to move proteins and other necessary nutrients all the way through the cell. So they have this railroad system. And basically, it's all made up of little bridge parts. And so what the tau does is kind of stabilizes that whole railroad system within the nerve cell, the microtubules. And so it allows for proper communication. That's what we think tau does. Why it accumulates in Alzheimer's and gets modified into a toxic protein. We really don't know all of that, but that's what it is. You can imagine that when it's not working well, that's a problem. And so what people are trying to think is, well, maybe the tau is part of the story, right? And so it turns out that that now we can measure tau with another PET ligand. This one is not yet FDA approved, but within Alzheimer's disease is looking very promising. And you can basically give the same logic to the PET scan before, but now this agent sticks to tau instead of sticking to an amyloid. And it turns out that if you have somebody who has amyloid, they're amyloid positive, this is on the next slide, and here's an example of somebody who has no amyloid and a little bit of tau. Because a little bit of tau is part of normal aging. But here's a person who has some amyloid and not much tau, and that's why they're cognitively okay. But here's a person with amyloid who's got some tau accumulated, and that kind of person is one who's going to start to show cognitive impairment very soon. So people are starting to think, I'm sorry for kind of moving out of order, that we have to move earlier. And so one strategy is, if we get the amyloid people before they've had much tau accumulated, then that's an opportunity to treat them when the amyloid therapy might work. Maybe once the tau is accumulated, it's getting kind of, there's too much going on. And so we even have studies now where we're enrolling people in the asymptomatic phase. It's called the A4, anti-amyloid treatment in asymptomatic Alzheimer's, A4. And that's a controversial definition called an asymptomatic Alzheimer's. But that, more importantly, is people who have amyloid are clearly at risk, and they're giving them this drug to try to see if, indeed, several years down the road after you're taking this drug, is there less cancer developing tau and cognitive symptoms. So they jump all the way back to that normal aging kind of scenario to see if these amyloid drugs actually can have a clinical effect. Now I walked you through tau, so obviously tau is another agent to think about all this stuff. And I want to talk a little bit, we're going to talk more about treatment for tau in a minute, but now I want to shift gears a tiny bit, because the other thing about dementia is it's not all Alzheimer's disease. So let's say you have a drug against amyloid, but the person doesn't have amyloid, but they have something else, and of course the answer is yes. So what I wanted to tell you is those clinical syndromes are recognizable as well. So it's not just, well, I look for Alzheimer's and it didn't sound like Alzheimer's, so it must be something else. There are, you know, very specific examples of these things, and they're recognizable. So I'm going to give you an example of a patient. You can tell me if anybody knows what they have without having to see the video before, because it's an old one. You can yell it out. Oh. Sorry, I just want to give you some context here, right? This guy has been admitted to the hospital as part of a research protocol. You can see the edge of the hospital bed there. And he's been asked to kind of tell why he's here. And along the way, this story that he's telling comes up. And I think in the end of the video, here is why he's sort of acknowledging that, in fact, this is a common problem they face and deal with in regular life.
Yeah. That word, he begins by the time he has heart all over his chair. Heart and gun is doing his whole cabin away.
Which reminds me, we got a lot of heart over this year.
Yeah, this time of year, the heart number.
Yeah. And the farts, yes. Lots of farts. I'm just seeing my left
heart. Okay. I didn't say either. I love the heart song. So it's only a very small snippet for time purposes, but this is a guy who basically, you know, was functioning normally out in the community, and his social functions have changed. But he starts making silly puns and silly songs, and it occupies his time. So he does it in inappropriate places, like the hospital. He just comes out and says, "I'm going to sing this part song." And that was about those topical things. It was about George Bush, who was president at the time. He was not happy with George Bush. This is not a political discussion I'm trying to bring up, but the point is, actually, if you listen to what he was singing, it was quite topical, it represented things that are going on at the time, and his memory was pretty good. And the problem was that he was singing about it in you can argue anymore in appropriate ways, but it was in an appropriate place. So anybody know what that was diagnosis, Skyler? FTD, somebody said frontotemporal dementia, and that's correct. That's what he had. He had frontotemporal dementia, which is another neurodegenerative disease that's different than Alzheimer's disease. It primarily presents with problems with social and emotional behavior. Social disinhibition is one example. It's a very common one, but there's also more subtle things like loss of empathy for others. So you get stories about, well, I went to the hospital and then I came back and I was still in bed from my gallbladder surgery, and my husband was kind of asking when dinner was, you know, if I was going to cook that, or all kinds of stories like that. Or I called from the hospital, it was often a hospital thing, you know. I called and I had a heart attack, and he said, well, are you okay? And he said, yeah. He said, okay, tell me when you want to get picked up and I'll come get you. Things like that. You have to ask those stories, but if you kind of lay out an example, you can get them. They have poor judgment, they overeat. They eat too much, they gain weight, they get weird food fetishes, which can be a kind of form of compulsive behavior. They don't get other kinds of compulsions. And basically many of the symptoms of OCD, without the anxiety or the worry about it, that OCD patients have, are often a part of the FTD presentation. They get apathy, lost interest in things in life, they get very friendly, they're not disgusted by disgusting things. In some other talk, I think there's a lot to do with all this. And what I'm trying to bring up is the idea that, so as I will point to in a minute, this disorder is caused by a different set of proteins than Alzheimer's disease. There's overlap, we'll talk about that too. But it's not the same amyloid that we talked about in Alzheimer's disease. And the kind of rule that I'm bringing up now is that that's the way neurodegenerative diseases are. Each of them is associated with some selective vulnerability of certain brain systems and certain proteins. And it turns out when this protein, like amyloid and tau, affects the brain, it often gets these memory systems first. But when other proteins affect the brain, it can affect other systems in the brain. And so really, when we're trying to make a diagnosis, we must probe for dysfunction in all of those systems that I laid out earlier. And if you want to break them into kind of broad categories, I like this kind of approach, which is memory. We talk about which disease is most of memory, but if you go with social and emotional function and also language, there's a syndrome called progressive aphasia, where people get an aphasia-like syndrome, but it's slowly progressive instead of sudden stroke. And when you get those things, it's often due to the proteins that cause frontotemporal dementia. And then there's movement. Frontotemporal dementia, those proteins can also be associated with movement disorder. But a common one that we talk about is, of course, Parkinson's is another neurodegenerative disease that's caused by different proteins, synuclein, and that is associated with movement trouble. But when those synuclein proteins affect the rest of the brain besides just the movement system, you get this other syndrome, which Elizabeth referred to, called Lewy body dementia, which is really a combination of the symptoms of Parkinson's and the symptoms of cognitive impairment, like Alzheimer's disease. And also it has a more psychiatric flavor, so it's more likely to be associated with early delusions and hallucinations, and Alzheimer's disease is. So it's really important when you're trying to make a diagnosis, really, and it's all based on history, for the most part, you probe for all these systems, because the combination of symptoms tells you what systems you're involved, and that points to the protein. So it turns out, as I mentioned, that pathology is not amyloid. It's made up of tau, again, but the tau is in a different kind of form than it is in Alzheimer's disease. And in fact, that accounts for about half FTD. And the other half is this other protein called TDP43. You don't have to remember it, but I'm just kind of laying out the idea that, you know, it's quite predictable that if you have certain kinds of aphasia, we're going to see TDP43 in the brain. If you have other kinds of symptoms, we're going to see tau in the brain. And sometimes we don't know for sure if it's going to be tau or TDP, but it's going to be one of them. And again, to kind of reinforce this selective vulnerability, it's no surprise that when these proteins happen, we could develop these symptoms of social and emotional behavior, because that's the part of the brain these disorders hit. So I like to show this by comparing imaging maps of brain atrophy. So similar to the one I showed early in the course, but a different kind of coloring system. So So, you know, Alzheimer's disease can affect the frontal lobes too. This is now a kind of whole brain, three-dimensional view of the brain, from the right, from the left, from the bottom, and then opening up the brain, so we'll get that middle wall the same as before. And what you see in Alzheimer's is you have some involvement in the frontal lobes and some involvement in a part of the brain called the parietal lobes, and this is where the getting lost comes from, we think, or the language is on the left side. But in FTD, you have diffuse involvement of the frontal lobes and the temporal lobes. And probably most importantly, you have involvement of these parts of the brain that call the orbital frontal cortex and the medial frontal cortex. And those are parts of the brain that we know are important for social and emotional function. So that is why these patients present like this, because that's kind of ground zero for this protein to bother. And has anybody heard of Phineas Gage? He's kind of a famous guy. He was the first case where people had recognized in the late 19th century that a physical injury to your brain can affect personality, and not just things. You think of as cognition and language and memory. And so Phineas Gage basically had a big railroad spike go right up through exactly this part of the brain. And amazingly, he survived, and his physician was able to describe how he had changed. So these people really, they're the modern Phineas Gage. They have the same kinds of symptoms as he does, but of course from a different cause. And the thing is, when you think about these disorders, age is a big component of how you think about it. So remember I said Alzheimer's is the most common dementia probably? Well, that's because it's dementia associated with older age, past 65 or 70. That's the most common time to get Alzheimer's disease. And because, because that's the most common time to get any dementia, that's what we see most. But when people are younger than 65 and they present the symptoms of dementia, Alzheimer's is not the most common anymore. It's maybe 30-40%, and it starts to include other kinds of dementias. And some studies have shown that FTD or a related thing might be as high as 50%. That's not really represented in this slide, but so once you're under 65, you certainly have to think about Alzheimer's, and it could be unusual or less memory and more of some of the other symptoms that I talked about. But you also have to start thinking about FTD-related things, just from the age, as well as the one of the things I like to point out, and I think it's great for this, because you guys have been talking about psychiatric symptoms a little bit later, is not only are they part of an established dementia syndrome, but because many of the symptoms that I just described in diseases like FTD are symptoms that are present in psychiatric syndrome, like depression and compulsions and apathy, they often get misdiagnosed. This is a study done by Doc Williams, a psychiatrist now, in our department, and UCSF, and he did a study looking back at which patients had psychiatric diagnoses before they got to us, and we diagnosed them with dementia. And it turns out, that one of the important things is, we diagnose people with psychiatric diseases a lot when they don't have them, when they have their Geriatric disease. And that's true for every syndrome, even plain old Alzheimer's disease. We sometimes misdiagnose as depression, and that's an issue. But we do a lot more with FTD. So about 50% of patients with FTD got diagnosed mostly with depression, sometimes bipolar, occasionally with schizophrenia, before they were diagnosed with FTD. So it's a really important thing to recognize that if you're thinking about a psychiatric sort of late in life, that you have to entertain the idea that this could be neurodegenerative. And in fact, we can give you a lot of guidelines and tools to know when it is and when it isn't, but so the best I can do is alert you to the possibility now and look for and be aware of it, have a lower threshold for referral, and look for more research hopefully over time. And to apply the diagnostic tools that we have. So it turns out that using the same clinical approach, mainly a history, assisted maybe with some cognitive testing, you know, you can diagnose these things. So that's the sensitivity of clinical criteria that we laid out. It's about 80%, and that's been shown in autopsy confirmed cases. So the criteria we have, if you read them, they're useful for this purpose. This is just to show that if we add amyloid to that, it can help more. So if you suspect that somebody has FTD and you were to get an amyloid scan and it showed a lot of amyloid, you start to rethink that. But if it didn't show amyloid, that would be consistent with your diagnosis. And this was a large study that showed that in most cases with clinically diagnosed FTD-related syndrome. The likelihood of having amyloid in the brain was very low, and it was higher for Alzheimer's disease and the atypical forms of Alzheimer's disease, and even in Lewy bodies, there's often a mix, as Elizabeth was alluding to. So you know, that amyloid is going to be a good tool for us when we're trying to think about atypical things. And so you might say, well, FTD is a child disorder, right? I said so. And you have that tau imaging stuff. But how does it work in FTD? And it turns out, not so bad, but it's not there yet. So these are, this is actually a patient who had, you know, any dementia you might get, it's rare, but due to an autosomal dominant mutation. So it turns out that there are families that have an autosomal dominant mutation in the gene that codes for tau running in their families. And in those families, if you have that mutation, it's highly likely you're going to get, unfortunately, FTD or some variety of it. And so we've looked at patients who, in those cases, we know they have tau because they have that mutation. So they don't have to be equally free as a cause. And in some of those cases, we find that we can see an elevation of tau with this tau scanning agent that I talked about. But it's not reliable. There are other kinds of tau mutations where that's not the case. And there are even some people with CDP43 where we see some signal. So unfortunately, it's not reliable enough or useful enough yet to use it to diagnose in the setting of FTD. The tau is really good for AD. And that's because that's what it was developed for. So we're still working on that. But I am painting the picture that this kind of approach where you're using imaging or other kinds of biomarkers, they're called now, to enhance your clinical impression, that's the future of diagnosis. And it's just a matter of when and balancing cost against anything. So this whole talk is meant to kind of highlight the importance of non-Alzheimer's proteins, right? That they're out there, they cause a lot of syndrome. And this is another one that people have heard about in the news lately, this chronic traumatic encephalopathy. You come to recognize that having exposure to multiple, and many times subconcussive head injuries, like from football over time, increases the risk of dementia down the road. It's gotten a lot of news lately, as I'm sure many people know. And the symptoms of that are not completely well-defined, but they have a cognitive syndrome that's sometimes Alzheimer's-like. A lot of times it's a little more executive, organizational, that kind of thing. And it also often has a prominent emotional component, where there's depression and apathy, irritability, aggression. And we even see, it seems like, syndromes where if you're starting to be affected earlier in life, like when you're in your 30s or 40s or 50s, that this emotional component might be stronger. And then if you make it through all that and get into the more typical dementia kind of ages, like 60s, 70s, 80s, that it has a more typical dementia-looking pattern. But all of that is very preliminary, and people will have to learn. But the point is, it's a real disease with a real cause. And if you look in the brain at people who have chronic traumatic encephalopathy, the protein you see is tau. So it's another example of one has to be aware of these kind of tau. So understanding the role of these non-Alzheimer's proteins in neurogenesis is going to be an important part of how we treat. Probably Alzheimer's, but also non-Alzheimer's. FTD is kind of, and understanding tau and CDP43 is a real important window into even Alzheimer's disease and other diseases. So I can't talk about all of them, but there are other clinical syndromes. Something called progressive supranuclear palsy and cortical basal degeneration. These are atypical, uncommon forms of Parkinson's disease, and they're actually not caused by synuclein, Parkinson's related protein that I mentioned earlier, they're caused by tau. So they are biologically a form of FTD, but different parts of the brain are vulnerable. Why is that? We're trying to learn, but you know, understanding these proteins really has an impact on a lot of different syndromes. And even that protein TP43, which I linked to FTD, it turns out you can see that in about 30% of cases with Alzheimer's disease, and we think it's playing a role clinically. And it's the protein that's associated with Lou Gehrig's disease, or ALS. And that's the protein in all of them. And it turns out that one of the mutations that causes FTD also causes Lou Gehrig's disease, same mutation, either syndrome. So these links with other things and other proteins is growing. So obviously, we've talked about tau a lot in other programs, and for several years, people have recognized that maybe we shouldn't just think about amyloid. Let's start to develop treatments oriented for tau. And this is just a slide that summarizes that. There's a lot of treatments people have talked about that trying to boost the cellular breakdown of tau or stabilizing those microtubule load, you know, railroad things they talked about, trying to reduce the expression. We'll talk about that in a minute. Vaccines, so immune agents that try to help the immune system clear out the tau. All of these are under development. And one kind of cool thing that I like to talk about, and this is a disclosure thing, and this is a company that I happen to consult with, but there's a really important kind of neat mechanism that I think got a lot of attention and focus lately, is these antisense oligonucleotides. You know what those are? So antisense oligonucleotides basically, you know, you can, so how any protein in the body is coded by a strand of DNA. The base mRNA, right? So you can now make a strand of DNA that's opposite to the strand of DNA that makes the protein, so that it binds to it and it prevents that protein from being made. And so you can do that with any protein you want. You can do it with tau or TDP43 or whatever you want. And it's really the technology and advance, we've been doing this for many years, is being able to make these strands of DNA so they don't get broken down immediately. Maybe stay in the body for long enough to get where they're supposed to go. But now they can do that. And actually, I believe it's the first study, they've already gotten approval for one of these drugs for spinal muscular atrophy, which is a very rare form of childhood type of ALS. And using an ASO, they've gotten these kids who really are dead by, I think, a year or two to be walking around at a year or two. So it's a very rare disorder, it's a very specific thing, but as a proof of concept, it's really important well beyond that. So they're making anti-sense oligonucleotides against the Huntington's protein, against tau, against other forms of FTD, and I focus on it because of its omnipotence in the sense of, like, you could suffer it, but, you know, you could use it in lots of different directions, because as long as you could find the right strand of DNA that's relevant, you could potentially use it. So that's why I think it's getting a lot of attention, because it can be useful in so many different ways. And currently, one of the companies is planning a study of anti-tau, anti-sense oligonucleotide, both in FTD and AD, and another company is planning it in a form of FTD caused by one ALS-related mutation, and also treating ALS. But I think this kind of therapy is definitely something among the many to keep an eye on. This is my last slide. This is a little bit of a plug for work that I've done with people like Dr. Scanlon. UCSF, where I work, is one of 10 state Alzheimer's centers. Stanford is another one, and there are eight others around the state. And, you know, we're all funded to contribute to care and train in dementia. And one of the things we recognize is that the principles that I just laid out, you know, you're not rocket science, but you have to know what you're looking for, and you have to know how to recognize when you see it. And so we decided to create a toolkit which helps primary care physicians or anybody, or, you know, any experts, so it could be experienced nurses who know how to listen to dementia symptoms, or any of staff that could do this, but it doesn't require some judgment. I don't think you can answer an administrator who doesn't have that kind of clinical judgment, but it basically takes you through all the questions that you should ask. And it tells you what answers would worry us and what answers wouldn't. And through that, it tells you who sounds like you should be referring them to a center, like one of our 10 centers, and who is, well, if you're going to say this Alzheimer's, we would probably agree as well, based on the outcomes of these questions. So that's the logic of it. I think there'll be a lot of work to do with it. And we recognize there are barriers to using it, like time in the primary care setting. We know that, but that problem doesn't change the approach we have to take to diagnosing. So at least as a first pass, it's an educational tool to help people understand, like, what do I need to look out for? And they'll have to try to figure out how to help you do it. And it does include guidance on doing it, that if you're in a setting where you can at least build for your time and know you're doing it, it tells you, oh, you spend this much time to do that, use this code, and you should be able to. So this should be out in the summer. I keep an eye out for it if you're interested in thinking about these principles. So that's the end of the talk. So we've made a lot of progress in biology, which is going to lead us to new treatments that are disease modifying. Those biological changes are also helping us with diagnosis and the tools to measure them. And we're not going to really have good treatments unless we have good diagnoses. There's more knowledge things we can treat with drugs through. And I told you, I think the new treatments that are going to be most effective are going to be directed at the disease-causing proteins. And I think that last slide was really a pitch to say that all of this won't really change unless the whole medical system that starts with primary care starts to think about the differential diagnosis and that Alzheimer's can specifically be diagnosed and identified rather than this kind of wastebasket, it's diagnosis and exclusion approach, which is all. So that's kind of it. So I have 2 minutes for questions. Yes. Oh. Go ahead. So I think I'll try to hopefully I'll try to summarize the question briefly with by saying I think that the same who's a psychologist kind of comments about that her husband mild cognitive impairment, but is a person who is very bright and has a lot of skills that involve a lot of brain areas. And essentially, I think the question is, you know, how does that affect our diagnostic assessment, and does it change the accuracy of it, and where can she get better access to it? So, even more so. So I think it's important for me to mention diagnostic changes, though. So I think it's important that people know, as psychologists, there are some here who can agree or disagree, is that has an impact on how we interpret your performance on your psychological testing. What your baseline, what your abilities are baseline. But it's not everything. The tests that we designed are meant to probe these parts of the brain that pursue these functions. And they're quite sensitive in many different contexts, including people who are Nobel Prize winners. And so I don't want people to walk in and say, these tests can't do anything because, you know, I'm too smart for them. But these tests are really well designed to capture these things. They're not 100% accurate. Neuropsychological testing. So then the other thing is about treatment, that's a whole different question. One of the issues that comes up is, what is the role of cognitive training, cognitive exercises on that time? In treatment, I think it's worth just answering that too, which many people don't want to know. We don't know. So we know that if you train on a cognitive game, it will make you better at the game. It might make you a little better at other kinds of tasks. We're not totally sure about that yet. There are some studies that point in that direction. But if you're asking the question, will it be less likely to make me have cognitive impairment 5 years from now, or make my cognitive impairment less severe, we don't know yet. And that's what many studies work on. I'm sorry, I ran out of time. I want to respect my schedule, so I'm going to stop, even though. But I'm going to stay for a bit, at least on the first break, so that I can answer some more questions. Thank you.